Well, it's good to be with you all again. We've come to the end of our Satisfied series where we get an opportunity to close out Colossians. I hope that you've been enjoying the Word of God over the last couple months as we've been diving in to this rich but small book. But before we go any further, I want to pause and ask the Lord Jesus to be with me as I communicate his truth this morning. As always, those that are part of our family know that I often say is, no one came to church to hear from me today. But we came to hear from Jesus Christ. We came to hear from the Word. And so if you would, please, bow your heads with me in a word of prayer as we get started, as I go to work. Father, thank you so much for your Word that we stand on. And thank you so much that it is truly because you live that we can face tomorrow. And I pray that every person under the sound of my voice today would be able to hear the Word of God with clarity and with focus. And thank you for your servant Paul, who is speaking to us. We pray all these things in the matchless name of Jesus Christ. Amen. So I grew up in the inner city, and one of the things that we love to do in the hood is shout-outs. And we don't do shout-outs at Harvest Bible Chapel, but if we did do shout-outs, this would be the verse. These would be the text. This would be the text that I would use, Colossians chapter 4, verse 8 through 18. And in a moment, I'm going to share through these verses, and you may read this as sometimes we look at the Bible and we get to the end of a letter and we just kind of skim through it so that we can get to the next thing. But I want to call your attention to these verses because they're not verses to skip over, but they're rich in not only meaning, but manifestation of the things that we've already been learning together over the last few months. So if you haven't been with us in Colossians, let me just summarize a couple things that we've come to know in this text. The central theme of Colossians is that Christ is Lord over all creation, seen and unseen, that he is powerful, and that he is Lord over everything. The first two chapters are deep and rich in doctrine and theology. How many here just love doctrine and theology? You just love, my nerd friends. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. All 18 of you. Those first two chapters are for you, that he gets deep in Christology and helps us understand who Jesus is, why he did what he did, who he claims to be, and why is that important for us. But then the last two chapters, Paul turns the tables. And what he begins to do is he helps us understand how Christ's redemption helps us in our character, how to live not only in our house, but how to live with one another. And so he gets to this part of the text. And I want to read this and be very careful as I read it so that you can hear the words that Paul is sharing with us. And then after I read it, I'm going to go back and we're going to highlight each of these verses and unpack them together. So I'm going to start at the seventh verse. Tychicus will tell you all about my activities. He is beloved, a beloved brother and faithful minister and fellow servant of the Lord. I have sent him to you for this very purpose, that you may know how we are and how to encourage your hearts. And with him, Onesimus, our faithful and beloved brother, who is one of you. They will tell you of everything that has taken place here. And then I love this word. I'm going to just butcher it, but I'm going to do my best because I've done it all week. Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner, greets you, and Mark, the cousin of Barnabas, concerning whom you received instructions. If he comes to you, welcome him. And Jesus, who's called Justice. These are the only men of the circumcision among my fellow workers for the kingdom of God, and they have been a comfort to me. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ Jesus, greets you, always struggling on your behalf in his prayers, that you may stand mature and fully assured in all the will of God. For I bear him witness that he has worked hard for you and for those in Laodicea and in Hierapolis. Luke, the beloved physician, greets you, as does Demas. Give my greetings to the brothers of Laodicea and to Nympha and the church in her house. And when this letter has been read among you, have it also read in the church of Laodiceans, and see that you also read the letter from Laodicea. And say to Archippus, see that you fulfill the ministry that you have received in the Lord. I, Paul, write this greeting with my own hand. Remember my chains. Grace be with you. May the Lord have a blessing to the reading of his holy word. One of the things that I want you to gather from today, if you don't gather anything else, is this. Ordinary people matter to God. Ordinary people matter to God. So often people think because you have a microphone or because that you have a special gift that somehow you have a special place in the eyes of the Lord. And I want to come against that lie today with as great boldness as I possibly can, that ordinary people matter to God. There is nothing special about position. It is about the fact that we have received Jesus Christ as our Lord and our Savior. And so our first point is this: faithful servants bring encouragement. Faithful servants bring encouragement. Tychicus, who I'm going to just call Master T, because if I say that name too many times, I might get messed up. So Master T is first mentioned here, and it's just not anything or just a word or a name, and we move on. But we find out some very significant things about Master T that I want to share with you. The first thing we find out is that he's beloved. That he's beloved. Just this intimacy that you hear from Paul, the Apostle Paul, who, by the way, is in jail. And we hear him talking about a friend who's beloved. But he doesn't just stop there. He also says that he's faithful. Isn't it amazing that generations and generations later that we have a text where someone is mentioned, Master T, is, we hear that he's beloved and he's faithful. I think that so many times that we focus on fruit. We focus on the results. We want to see God move and we want to see lots of things happen. We want to see hundreds of thousands of people who are following him, and that is perfectly true. But the reason why people follow Christ is because someone is faithful to Christ. And so we find out that he's not just beloved, he's not just faithful, but the Bible also lets us know that he's a messenger. He's a messenger. He's bringing this letter to the church. Just imagine with me for a moment if Paul gave that letter to someone who wasn't dependable. Hey, I need you to take this letter that I wrote in jail. I need you to take this letter and make sure that it gets to the church. Paul, you know, I was checking my calendar. I got to go see my mom. You know, I got some cousins that want me to hang out. I'm going to spend a couple days with them fishing. I hope that I actually make it to the church, and hopefully that I remember the letter. I don't think that Paul was giving his letter to anyone that was like that, amen? I think he was giving it to someone who was dependable, and he knew that he would get that letter to God's people. As I was studying this week, I was wondering to myself, can you imagine Paul giving you a letter, and you don't know what's in it, and he tells you to read it to God's people, and you're in it. How amazing must it have been for Master T to be reading this letter, and then all of a sudden, he hears his name. And he hears Paul saying that you're beloved, that you're faithful, that you're a dependable messenger. But then the last part that I love is that he says that he may encourage your hearts. That we find out that Tychicus is an encourager. Have you ever had a person in your life that they just bring you joy? I mean, when you see them and you walk in, there's something that just in your spirit that just perks up. You're just so happy to see them. I hope that I'm that type of person as a pastor that when people see me, they don't go, oh my goodness. Oh boy, it's our pastor again. I hope that there's some joy that comes from being together that it can encourage your spirit, that there's something that you hear that brings you great encouragement. And Tychicus was that type of person. And I love that he says that he wasn't alone. There was someone else that was with him as well. And before I mention him, I want to just say this one thing that I think is very important for us to remember. It's that there is greatness in the smallest things being done for Christ. There is greatness in the smallest things being done for Christ. Every week I get the opportunity to see this room slowly begin to fill. But what you don't know is at about 6:30 to 7:30, people start coming in who are ordinary people just like you, getting ready for the service. The majority of people on this stage, they all are volunteers. There are people who are in the production that are getting the sound right so that I can communicate the word of God. There are people who are using their gift of hospitality to cook food to be able to serve every Sunday the people who serve on worship. There are amazing ushers who give you amazing pieces of paper that you can write on so that and say good morning and help you feel comfortable. In a little while, there'll be some people who are going to be serving the Lord's Supper as we gather together to remember the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Every last one of those people are great in the eyes of the Lord. Amen? I was thinking about for myself a couple brothers who have encouraged me in my spirit in the recent months. Matt Woodhead is working right now in security. He's out in the lobby. And Elvin Velez, one of our elders, both of them. These brothers, we call them ride or die brothers in the hood. These are the brothers, you don't have to go into the story. You just mention that you need help and they come at the ready. These are guys who you just tell a little bit of the story and they finish the sentence. Why? Because they are praying for you. They're lifting you up. They know what you're going through. And I love that you can depend on them. Isn't it a wonderful thing to have friends like that? And if you don't have a friend like that, I'm praying today that the Lord would lift up relationships in your life that will encourage you. So in your notes, I want you to think about someone who encourages you. I want you just to write their name. Someone who encourages you. Just write their name. He continues, and he says, Onesimus is with him. A faithful and beloved brother who is one of you, meaning he is one of the Colossians. What I love about it is that he says, they will tell you everything that has taken place. Before we move any further, Onesimus is not a name to skip over. Because there's a small book of the Bible called Philemon that's a few pages over to the right. So let me tell you a little bit about Onesimus. This dude, for his pleasure, ran away from his slave owner. Notice that Paul does not address him as a bondservant or a slave. He calls him a brother and a fellow servant. So Onesimus ran away from his owner. The Bible lets us know that he probably stole some money from his owner as well and hightailed it away from Philemon. But something happened while he was running. He ran into a dude that we're going to meet a little bit later, Eze, otherwise known as Epaphras. And he ran into Epaphras and he gave his life to the Lord. And he started to follow the teachings of Paul, and then he met Paul. Paul invited him to be in his service. And so he began to minister together. I don't know about you, but if somebody ran and stole something from me, they would not be the first person that I would be making a candidate to join me in sharing the gospel. Can I just be honest? I know for many of you, you're more spiritual than me, but Onesimus would not be the first person that I would run to and ask to join me on a mission. But I'm so glad that I'm not Jesus and that I'm not Paul, because the gospel transforms us, amen? Some of us who are sitting here under the sound of my voice need to hear this statement, that your past is not a ceiling that determines your destiny. Your past is not a ceiling that determines your future. Some of you that are here have colorful pasts before Christ. If I could just take your brain and your mind and flash it up on the screen just for about 10 minutes, we'd have some real church up in this place. If I just said, Lord, I just was curious, you know, what was Juan like before he came to Christ? Let me just throw that life up there on the screen. What was Will like, Lord, before he said yes to you and married Bruce Day? Let's just put his name up on the screen. But I want to encourage each and every one of you that is, in fact, that part of your story, the E-True Hollywood story, that the Lord wants to use to bring people to himself. Some of us live in shame and condemnation. And the Lord Jesus Christ is saying to you today that your past is not a limitation on your future. That he wants to use you right where you are. But the second thing is, present friends bring comfort. Present friends bring comfort. Aristarchus is a true friend. This brother is a fellow prisoner, and he sends his greetings with Paul. But what you may not know about Aristarchus is that often when Paul went to jail, he voluntarily went to jail with him. When Paul was flogged and when Paul was disturbed and when Paul was praying and fasting and seeking God for the people, Aristarchus was right there with him. Jailed, shipwrecked, stoned, he was with him. You know what's interesting to me about friends? Some people like to be your friend until danger comes, and then they disappear. Anyone ever experienced that in friendship? Yeah. Where someone is with you, but then when hardship comes, they go. But I love that Aristarchus, he didn't do that. He stayed with Paul until the end. I wonder if our friends that we have at work, some of our neighbors, people that God has brought into our lives, I wonder if we understand the significance of what it means to be their friend. That they can depend on us when things get tough. The reality is that failure is never final in the kingdom. And everything that he experienced and everything that Paul experienced, they did it together. But there's another person that is mentioned there, and his name is Mark. And I want you to hone in on this, because this one, I think, is a great tension for us. He says that Mark, the cousin of Barnabas, concerning whom you've received already instructions, if he comes to you, welcome him. Well, why would he say that about Mark? You might want to write down these two scriptures, Acts chapter 13, verse 13. Acts chapter 13, verse 13. And then the second is Acts chapter 15, verses 27 through 40. Acts chapter 15, verses 27 through 40. Why did I give you those verses? It's because Mark has an interesting past with Paul. There's a little disagreement that Barnabas and Paul had together, because on Paul's first missionary journey, there was someone on the trip with him named Mark. Same guy. And Mark started well with him, but then Mark got to a point, he said, excuse me, I'm going home. I'm out. I'm not staying with you, Paul. I'm going to desert you. I'm leaving. And he left and went home. Paul wasn't too happy about it. And in the second scripture that I gave you, he made it entirely clear that he thought that Mark was useless and he didn't need him. Have you ever been with someone in the body of Christ who's a friend, who turned their back on you, who hurt you, and you said, I'm done? I don't really need you as a friend. I unfriended you. I stopped following you. I stopped calling you. I changed my number. I don't even want to know that you're still in the same city. That's the way I feel. Now, before we throw shade on Mark, I want to confess that the old Ed was a lot like the old Paul. I didn't have a problem Xing you out of my life, and I didn't even think about you. You hurt me. That's fine. I'm done with you. Anybody else like that? Thank you for the five people who are telling the truth in the church. But what I love about this is Paul is modeling forgiveness. The reason why is it was only 6 miles away, one of the places that is in our passage today, and the other was about 100 miles away. So everybody in this church would know the story about Mark. But he takes the time to put in the word of God in the letter, Mark and I, we're all good. That's my boy. If he comes to you, you are to receive him. He is awesome. He is a blessing. He's with me. And later in 2 Timothy, we find out that he was with him on his last missionary journey. Mark and Paul reconciled together. So here's a hard question. Who do you need to reconcile with? Who do you need to ask forgiveness to make it right? You once were close and tight, but something came between you and you are no longer the close friends that you are. Who is it that you need to speak to and you need to challenge yourself in the Lord and say, I think that I need to ask for forgiveness. I don't know who that is for you, but my prayer is that you would do it. Because the gospel and the testimony of the gospel is at stake. So he doesn't stop there. He mentions probably the most unfortunate name in the whole chapter, Jesus, who we often call Justice. I just love that. Jesus, you know, it was a common name back in the early century, first century church, but it's just, we don't know anything else about him. It's just Jesus, but we call him Justice. Can you imagine people calling his name and hearing his name? Hey, it's Jesus. Hey, we've got some, oh, you're not that Jesus. It's just Justice. It's Justice. Well, why did he mention these three people? Because these are the only three people who were Jewish that were with him on his journey. And then he continues in verse 12. Hardworking intercessors bring strength. Hardworking intercessors bring strength. He gets to Epaphras, who's one of my favorite guys in the book of Colossians. If you remember a few weeks ago in chapter 1, I believe it was verse 7, we find out that Epaphras is the one who planted this young church. What's beautiful about this is he didn't just plant this church, but the reason why he planted it is because he had heard the gospel in Ephesus. He received Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. And then the dude went back home and start telling everybody and planted this church. If you want to see a person who's a hero in Scripture, Epaphras is one of them. And I love what is mentioned about him. What's mentioned is not how many people are in the church. What's mentioned is not a number of his spiritual gifts. What is mentioned is how he served and prayed for God's people. Look at verse 12 with me. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ, greets you, always struggling on your behalf in his prayers, that you may stand mature and fully assured in all the will of God. That statement is enough, but listen to what else Paul says about him. For I bear witness that he has worked hard for you and for those in Laodicea and in Hierapolis. Here we find that he constantly is praying and working for God's people. But the second thing is he is fervently praying for God's people. That he's always lifting them up in prayer. The third thing that he did is he personally greeted them. That it was personal to him. It wasn't just anybody. These are my people. These are the folks that I know. These are the folks that I have slaved with and been so hard, fast, and pressed for the gospel with. This is not only someone who constantly prayed, who fervently lifted them up in prayer. He personally was engaged, and then he sacrificially served them, struggling on your behalf in prayer. There's a group of people that are at our church that often never are mentioned and hardly ever recognized. And it's exactly the way that they like it. It's called the prayer team. There's a few people that are here in our service today. I want to just ask you, if you're a member of the prayer team, just briefly, can you stand right where you're at? Right where you are, members of the prayer team. I see James in the back. I see this, all of you. Keisha, can we give God thanks for the members of the prayer team? Thank you guys so much. People often wonder, where do you get the power to preach the gospel? Where do you get the power to be able to clearly communicate? Where do you get the power and the strength to serve the Lord Jesus when everybody else seems to be falling? It's because of the prayer team. It's because of people who fervently and violently wrestle with the enemy in prayer. The Bible says that he struggled in prayer. The question is, when is the last time that you struggled in prayer for anything? Not your child, not your family, not things that matter to you, but when is the last time that you struggled in prayer for the gospel of Jesus Christ and for those that are serving? The Bible lifts up and calls people who struggle in prayer as heroes and sheroes. That's who they are. I couldn't do the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ by myself. It's the people who pray for me because they know how crazy I am. They know how sinful I am. They know that the Lord Jesus Christ is using me in this moment. I'm just a flash in the kingdom. But they pray and they lift up. Many of you want this type of prayer in your life. But the question is, are you willing to sacrifice for it? Are you willing to sacrifice for it? Are you struggling in prayer, or are you struggling to pray? Are you struggling in prayer, or are you struggling to pray? I'm finding in this season of my life that I don't pray because I want things from God. I pray because I need God. I need God. There is nothing that I can do personally. There is nothing that I can do personally without God. So I'm praying because I need him. I need him in my life. I need him to be the husband that I am called to be. I need him to be the father that I'm to be, the three kids. I need him to be with me because I don't have the wisdom of knowing how to lead God's people. It is he, through the community and the believers, who gives me the ability to do what I do. We need the Lord Jesus. But the fourth thing that he points out is shared ministry brings growth. Shared ministry brings growth. He mentions Luke. What I love about Luke is not a pastor. Luke is not a minister. He's not a missionary. Luke is a doctor who writes very well and is incredibly detailed. If you've ever read the Gospel of Luke and Acts, there are only two books, but he's written the majority of the New Testament out of two books. And it's interesting, as we look at Luke, listen to what he says about him. Luke, the beloved physician, greets you, as does Demas. Luke and Demas are an interesting combination of people. In Luke, it's an encouragement to the majority of us that are sitting here today, is that the majority of us are not ministers of the gospel, nor have any intent of being vocational ministers. But every last one of you are considered ministers of the gospel because you are representatives of Jesus Christ. Whether you're a homemaker, a grandparent that's retired, a school teacher, an attorney, a janitor, maybe you're doing mortgages for people, maybe you are an intercessor. Every last one of you are called, as Luke, to be manifest presence of Jesus Christ. But Demas is mentioned here. And Demas brought encouragement at this point of the journey. But Demas is the topic of one of the saddest verses of the Bible for me. I want you to turn over to 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 10. I want to pause because this word that I'm going to say is so challenging. But I want to issue a word of warning first to myself and then to you. Some of you who are here under the sound of my voice won't finish the journey of Christ well. We're all here. We're all following Jesus Christ. But something happened to Demas between this journey with Paul and his last journey. Because in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 10, is one of the saddest verses that I've ever read in the Bible. For Demas, in love with this present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica. We don't hear another word about Demas in the scriptures. I pray that Demas reconciled and renewed his relationship with Jesus Christ, but I don't know. But the Bible says that he was enamored with this present world. And at some point in being enamored with this present world, he became distracted. And his distraction led him away from the faith. Every person that's here knows what it's like to be challenged and to be tempted by what the world has to offer. Living in Chicago in 2019, there is no lack of temptation and pressure to yield to the world. But the reason why that Paul wrote this book is because he knew that the power to resist the world was in the power of Christ in community. That's the reason why we go to small group. That's the reason why that we worship together. You know, the hardest time to go to small group for me is when I'm in sin. I can go to small group, no problem, bro, when everything's going good. I cannot wait to get there, open up the Word of God, accountability time, bring it on. It's all good. You know, I had a good week in Jesus, absolutely. But what about the times that we all have when we're far from Christ? My mind has been in the wrong place. I fell off, Pastor Ed, and I got drunk last Monday night. You know what? I know that that's not what I should have done with her, but I did. And the shameful thing about it is I really don't feel any sense of forgiveness or any remorse. This is just who I am. So I'm not going to small group because I don't owe anything to you. I don't have to talk to you about what's going on in my life. Anybody ever been there before? Absolutely. Demas got there and he didn't make it back. So the caution to us is to be like Jesus. And when we're not, don't run from community, run to community. Amen? I love how C.S. Lewis puts it in this quote. No amount of falls will really undo us if we keep picking ourselves up each time. We shall, of course, be very muddy and tattered children by the time we reach home. But the bathrooms are all ready. The towels put out and the clean clothes in the airy cupboard. The only fatal thing is to lose one's temper and to give up. It is when we notice that dirt, that God is most present in us. It is the very sign of his presence. Don't try to cover up your dirt. Reveal it so that you know Jesus is close. He's closer than he ever has been. 1 Peter chapter 5, 8 and 9 says this. Be sober-minded and be watchful. Our adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him and be firm in your faith. He ends by giving a shout out to Nympha, telling her, thank you so much for letting us use your house. Girl, we love you. Keep on serving the Lord. Keep loving people. Keep using your gift of hospitality. And then he ends in these two ways. To Archippus, he says, dude, get after it. Fulfill what Jesus has given you, the call in your life. Don't lose heart. Tell him to fulfill the call that Jesus has on his life. And then he ends as he always does, by asking personally for prayer. And then he says, grace be to you. I'm praying that the Lord's grace would fuel each and every one of us. That as we've gone through this book, that we would know that Jesus Christ is Lord over all, that there's nothing that he can't do, that anything is possible with him. And in a few moments, after we worship together, we're going to remember the sacrifice that he made together. So let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your word. I thank you, Lord, that your word is quick and powerful. It's a two-edged sword. And Lord, I pray that for every person that's here under the sound of my voice, that they would know that you're more than enough and that your grace is sufficient and that we can serve you. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.